techniques. And we have Bourgeois teacher Gerbush talk from Bilkent University about the spatial extent of the tilt after effect.
Okay, I'm sharing my screen. Thank you so much for the introduction. In this presentation, I will talk about our study called the spatial extent of the tilt after effect. And tilt after effect is observed when prolonged exposure to a tilted contour causes change in the perceived tilt of the subsequently presented contour. So for example, if you adapt to this tilted grating, which is tilted clockwise, and then you see this straight contour, most probably you will perceive the straight contour tilted to the opposite direction as a result of the orientation adaptation. Extensive research has been done on the tilt after effect. However, in these studies, it was generally assumed as a local after effect that is observed only at the adaptive location, and the spatial extent of the tilt after effect has not been studied systematically before. In this study, we addressed this fundamental gap in the literature and investigated whether it's a local after effect or does it spread across the visual field. To do that, we collected data from 21 participants, and this graph shows our test locations where we tested the spread of the tilt after effect. X-axis shows the horizontal position and y-axis shows the vertical position of the gratings in degrees. And here the cross sign shows the central fixation point. The bold circle here shows the location of the adapter grating, and other gratings here with the names show the other test locations. So we tested spatial spread of tilt after effect at 15 test locations, including the adapter location. And our experimental design was looking like this. So first, participants are adapted to an adapter grating, which is always tilted to 15 degrees clockwise direction for 5,000 milliseconds. And they are presented with a blank screen, followed by a presentation of test grating for 100 milliseconds. And test grating was presented at a randomly chosen spatial locations among these 15 test locations. And orientation of the test gratings are determined by one up, one down staircase techniques. We had two staircases, and their step sizes change based on the reversal that you can follow from here. And then a blank screen for presented for 2000 milliseconds, where participants need to indicate the perceived tilt of the grating by pressing either right or left arrow key on a keyboard. And the control condition was exactly the same except for adaptation. And for data analysis, we calculate subjective verticality of test gratings by fitting a logistic regression function, and then calculate the tilt after effect magnitude by subtracting subjective verticality of control condition from adaptation condition. And finally, we performed one sample t-test to test whether tilt after effect magnitude is significantly different than zero. Here, our results are shown as a heat map. X-axis shows the name of the test location and y-axis shows the row of the test location. And here the circles show the locations of the test gratings, and again, both circles show the location of the adapter grating. And the stars in them show the significance of the tilt after effect magnitude. As you see, we observe significant tilt after effect magnitude at all test locations except one location over here. And we also see that the tilt after effect magnitude was highest at the adapter location, and it decreased as we go farther away from the adapter. So our behavioral conclusion from our behavioral studies is that tilt after effect is not a local after effect, and it's spread across the entire visual hemifield. And it shows some evidence for global mechanisms than local mechanisms regulating the orientation adaptation. And as you might guess, our next question was how the tilt after effect spreads across the different spatial locations. And we investigated this question through modeling. Hubel and Wiesel showed that primary visual cortex is organized in columns. So assume that this A, B, C are the locations in our visual field. It's argued that we have location columns in our primary visual cortex that are sensitive to these each locations, like you see here, A, B, C. And in each of these location columns, there are orientation selective neurons that has some preferred orientation activated most of that preferred orientation. And also as a result of orientation adaptation, responses of the tunic curve amplitudes near the adapting orientation get suppressed. In other words, they fatigue as a result of prolonged exposure, and this fatigue causes repulsive shift in the perceived orientation, and this is called fatigue theory of orientation adaptation. So assume that you adapt to an orientation that's shown by this green tunic curve here. And when you adapt, as you see here, its amplitude suppressed, and the location and the orientation tuned neurons that are closer to this orientation also get suppressed relatively. And as a result, our population response also shifts to the right direction, which is the effect that we observed in the tilt-after effect. So by combining this fatigue theory and organization of the primary visual cortex, we create the computational model here. So we use our human behavioral data, and it gives us the input stimulus orientation, stimulus location, and participants' response. So what we did is that we put this input orientation to a tuning curve, and tuning curve here was half height, half width, third degrees Gaussian. To show their activation, I tried to create an image, and to make two-dimensional image, I added a dummy dimension here. So it shows that the tuning curve responds to the 90 degree stimulus, which is showed by this red line here. As you see, the neurons that are selective to 90 degrees and closer orientations are activated more, and the others are less. And then we also added receptive field responses, and our receptive fields are modeled as 2D Gaussians. And it is also another example. Again, to make it two-dimensional image, I just showed spatial locations in a one row, which is the central row. So y is zero here. And as you see, the receptive fields that are sensitive to stimulus location activated more and others less. And then we calculated activation of neurons by just multiplying this tunic curve response and receptive field response element wise. And here, as you see, we also multiplied these with a factor W, which is the value that this tuning curves will be suppressed. So this is highlighted here because we will find this value of W through optimization by using human data. And I, again, like wanted to show how this activation looks like. So x-axis, again, showing only the central row, x locations, and y-axis shows the orientation channels. And we are again showing 90 degree stimulus at 10.5 x location. And as you see, like activation is just looking like this. Then by using this activation, we created the pooled orientation channel response by just summing the response of neurons at all spatial locations. And then we normalize this neuronal response so that we will find activation with respect to the activation of other neurons. And then we predicted the input orientation by using winner-take-all method. And to make it differentiable because of optimization, we use an approximation of argmax, which is called soft argmax. And to create a readout of this predicted orientation as a response, like it is tilted to left or right, we activate this predicted orientation with hard sigmoid. And then what we do is, like, we take this predicted perceived tilt and human perceived tilt. And by using these values, we optimize the W to in a way that it will minimize the loss between these two values. So then we predicted human performance by using a test data set that model has never seen before. And the accuracies are like this: without adaptation condition, model's accuracy was 73.7%. And adaptation condition, it was 79%, which is very good if we think that the chance level is 50%. And what is next is that physiological studies also show shifts in neurons' preferred orientations and receptive fields in addition to suppression due to orientation adaptation. So now we are training a second model, including orientation and receptive field shifts in addition to the suppression. That's all for our study. This is my lab page. This is me and my advisor. If you have any further questions, you can ask now or you can contact with us later. We will be very happy to answer. Thanks for listening.
Thank you very much, Bushra. That was really impressive. I'm sorry for the noise. I live next to a helipad.
That's okay.
We do have time for questions, exactly. Panelists and also participants, to please ask your questions or any ideas that spring to mind after Bushra's presentation. I thought it was really like such an obvious thing to kind of ask about the spatial extent of this effect. And I thought that was really interesting how you could kind of show that it was not just the localized thing. But what I didn't really quite catch, and this is probably because I don't do any visual things, what exactly is this effect? Like, how does it appear?
Okay, so if I go very beginning of the slides. So it is like this. If you adapt to a tilted grating, then you perceive the next grating tilted to a different direction because you just adapt to a certain orientation.
Okay.
Sorry, so it is like this here. Yeah. If you adapt to this clockwise tilted grating and then you present it with this straight contour, you will perceive the straight contour tilted to the counterclockwise, like the opposite direction, because you just adapted this.
Thank you. I missed that bit right at the beginning. Pranav also had a question. Pranav, you can unmute yourself and ask it if you want.
Yeah. Hi, nice talk. I loved it, but I didn't understand the reasoning between like why a soft argmax was then followed by a hard sigmoid. Like, why use the hard sigmoid in the end? Like, how did it perform without the hard sigmoid at the end? Yeah.
So I used the soft argmax. I just wanted to use winner take all method to predict orientation, which is shown previously that like it can predict the perceived orientation well in orientation adaptation cases. But I needed to make it differentiable. That's why I used it. What's the technique called soft argmax? It's just looking like the weighted average kind of, but you weight it with the softmax probabilities basically. And I used hard sigmoid because it's kind of a classification problem here, either it is tilted to the left or right. And I used hard sigmoid because like human behavior is like this. When they see it around vertical, like when they see the grating straight, they press it on the chance level, like they say right tilt to right as 50% probability. And when you make sigmoids regularly, it looks like very broad probability between 0 and 1. So I just want to make it like more straight looking, like more limited classification. And it performed actually better than the sigmoids in my classification.
Okay, yeah, makes sense. Thanks.